Before we start with our actual topic, I would like to do a short introduction. So Hans-Bernd Kittlaus, the chairman of ISPMA, and Barbara Häusel, who is an independent consultant, trainer, and also a fellow member of ISPMA, and I, Sabrina Cortes from ISKI, will guide you through this presentation. So at first, I will start with giving you the body of ISPMA. Afterwards, I will hand over to our experts who will talk about the topic, how to handle software components in industrial IoT pricing. Please feel free to ask questions by using the question function during the webinar, and we will be happy to answer your questions at the end of the webinar. For those who haven't been in contact with ISKI before, some facts and figures for the start. ISKI has been founded in 2004 in Potsdam, Germany, and now we have three subsidiaries worldwide. In the Netherlands, in the UK, and in the US. So until today, ISKI conducted over 130,000 exams on 6 continents in 90 countries and 10 languages. We are working together with over 600 invigilators who are conducting exams every day globally for us. Moreover, I would like to explain you the cooperation model. Important that ISPMA does not conduct trainings. International training providers are responsible for that. They are developing the training material and conduct the trainings based on the syllabus. So here you see our product portfolio, which contains certifications in many different areas. We started in 2004 with software testing and now offer certifications in usability, in requirements engineering, in mobile app testing, and also software product management. And software product management is a very important topic, and the demand for the certifications in this area is growing constantly. We will give you some insights today. So now I'm very happy to hand over to our experts. Enjoy the presentation.
Well, welcome everybody to our webinar. Some of you may already be familiar with ISPMA, the International Software Product Management Association. I'm the chairman of that association. Barbara Häusel is one of our fellow members. And here you see the photos of most of our fellow members. So these are the people who actually develop the contents of ISPMA's body of knowledge. Well, this is ISPMA's curriculum with the foundation level training and 4 excellence level modules for training for software product managers. Each of these modules comes with certification. So if you are interested in training in general areas of a software organization, in the columns from strategic management through product strategy and product planning to service and support on the right side. And the core responsibilities of a software product manager are the columns product strategy and product planning, plus the areas of market analysis and product analysis, plus the orchestration of the other functional areas on the right side of the framework. ISPMA has published a book that is compliant to the current status of ISPMA's body of knowledge. We have also started to conduct our own conference last year. We had a wonderful conference this April in Frankfurt, and we have already planned the next one again in Frankfurt in March 2020. So if you are interested in joining us, go to this website. Also, if you are interested in contributing to the conference, maybe you want to present yourself, please contact us. So with that, I would like to hand over to Barbara, who will talk about how to handle software components in industrial IoT pricing.
So hello everyone, this is Barbara Häusel, and this topic of software pricing in the context of industrial IoT products is really interesting. So the reason why this topic has become very important over the last couple of years is that we see that software components contribute significantly to customer value of industrial IoT products, and this their share and contribution is increasing. And just so we have some shared understanding what I really mean here with software components in industrial IoT products, I would like to show the following example. This is a laser scanning and marking. Marking heads as an example. So if you are looking at the vendor of these scanning and marking heads, what they deliver obviously are these laser scan heads, and the laser scan heads already have software, of course, included as part of their functionality. And over the years, additional software has been added that provides additional functionalities, for example, configuration functionality to parameterize the laser heads and calibrate them, for example, custom programming. There's also software, for example, to define and control marking jobs. This software, this offering would be delivered to the customer of this component vendor, and the customer is the software modules from the OEM, from the machine vendor, but also may include some or all of the software packages provided by the vendor of the laser scanning and marking heads. And this then is delivered to the end customer, which is, for example, a company that operates a packaging line for a food manufacturer operating a packaging line. So just so a little bit for context, as we see, there's lots of software involved in what we tend to think of as a machine. And because of that high software content, it's worthwhile to look at how software products are, what's special about them and how they are different. And two things that are really important that distinguish software from physical products is one important thing is the different life cycle, and the other thing is legible or hardware product. And from a life cycle from development until first customer shipment, this part of the life cycle, then first of all, this typically takes months or even years, because there's also quite a delay introduced because the product needs to be manufactured and the production line needs to be set up and so on. In contrast, if we look at the extreme other example where we have software as a service, there we have an initial development phase that also might take some time. But then when the development and testing for the first release is done, the software can be deployed and reaches customers very quickly. And then also we can immediately start the update cycle to evolve the software and provide additional functionality. So one key difference that we see here is that software products typically get updates and require updates even after they have been sold and shipped, which means, on the other hand, from a financial point of view, that the vendor has ongoing development costs, while in the physical and hardware product world, we often have that there's kind of a pause where there's development engineering for a release, and then the version of the product gets manufactured and shipped for a certain period of time, a couple of years even, and then a new development engineering effort starts. But in between, the product doesn't evolve. And that's very different with software, because we continuously typically evolve software products. That leads to a different life cycle, where we have this initial conception or creation of the product and then introduce it to the market. And then we have, hopefully a growth phase, and the little pink dots on the curve indicate releases. So what you typically do is in the software world that we ship early. So we try to ship the first version that would be acceptable and sellable in the market. And then we evolve the functionality, the product becomes bigger and more complex and more functionality over time through the releases that we do after the market introduction. And even the customers who bought the first version of the product benefit from that because they receive the updates. So that's quite unique. So what we see here is that we use updates after shipment to continually evolve the software, but it also means that we have not only the initial development costs, but we have significant ongoing development costs. And that is very different from hardware products. So another thing that is different between software and hardware products, in hardware products, the product managers typically would spend a lot of time analyzing costs and in particular unit costs. So they would do something similar to what I show here, a bill of materials and labor costs for one unit of the hardware product. So they would analyze what it costs to manufacture one unit of the product. And these unit costs are usually significant, so they cannot just be ignored. And the point is that software does not have these unit costs because these unit costs are really for manufacturing and delivery, but they do not include the development costs. And in software, we have significant development costs, both the initial one that I showed and the ongoing ones. Costs, development costs, but these are not included in unit costing. And so that's these unit costs don't really make sense for a software product. That's why for a software product, instead of looking at unit costs like the hardware product manager would do, what we typically do is we look at total product revenue and compare that to product-related costs, and then we see whether we break even and whether we have enough profit to recoup our initial losses. Now, so the profitability question is not meaningful on a unit level. We typically, for software, pure software products, we do break-even analysis on the product level. And for that, we look across we aggregate all revenue streams related to the product. Because of these specifics of software, also our approach to pricing is quite different than compared to how hardware people often do pricing. So the general, approach to pricing. This is from a really standard textbook on pricing that's used by business schools globally, is that there are three key drivers for pricing decisions, and that applies to any product. So basically we need to consider relevant costs. We need to consider the competition and the market environment. And then we also, and that's a very important part, we need to consider the customer value. Now there's one caveat with the relevant costs, because relevant are only those costs that are incremental and avoidable. So these are really costs we should never consider sunk costs. So for example, all the development costs are sunk costs because once you're ready to ship the product, development should have been completed, hopefully. So what we're looking at is really only costs that would be avoided or the vendor would not incur if they wouldn't sell these units of the product. And so this is something that may be considerable in a hardware product, and therefore is often a major driver in pricing for hardware products. However, in software products, usually these relevant costs are very low or non-existent. And so we have some people say unfortunate situation that for software products, the relevant costs don't give us any guidance for pricing. In software, our pricing is typically purely based on value. So we look at the customer value of the product plus the environment with the competition and market environment, because the market environment also and the competition gives us some hints as to what customers are willing to pay for a certain value. So even the competition and market environment is in somewhat related to the customer value. Yeah, with that, then we can use also from the same textbook this concept of strategic pricing, where the authors suggest a pricing pyramid for value-based pricing, and the foundation layer of the pyramid, where everything starts with that, is they call it value creation. So that's really understanding the value of the product for the customer. Understanding the value of the product for the customer, ideally even in financial terms, that's what they call economic value. So if we can calculate, for example, the savings the customer would get from using our software, or additional revenue that our customer could generate by using our software or whatever. Then we have at the top of the pyramid the actual price tag we put on the product, and in between we have layers that help us to really realize the price that we want to achieve, so that we maximize our benefit basically. And that includes things like having a very good communication of the value of the product that we determine based on the value creation layer on the bottom of the pyramid. Because of the special situation that software has very low or negligible unit costs, we also see in software industry that we often use these unusual pricing and business models. So to us in the software industry, it's perhaps not so unusual, but to other industries, it's very unusual. And what do I mean by that? For example, things like free test versions or 65% student discounts, which is very common in the software industry. An example is Adobe does it with their software. And just think what would happen if I went to a car dealership and wanted to have a luxury car for free for 2 months to test. Or if I would say, here's my student ID card and I want a 65% discount on that car. That's not possible because of the other cost structure with the unit cost. But for software, it's very common. Other things that are very frequent in the software industry is freemium business models, where there's a free basic version and a paid premium version. LinkedIn is an example. Some mobile games use that model, or ad-based business models, as we know them from Google Search or Google Mail. We have a lot of flexibility here with the pricing and business models. However, usually because of the high ongoing development cost, for example, it's very helpful for software vendors if they have a recurring revenue stream. And let's look at revenue stream from an example. This is for a product that's called Jira Software. Many people in the software business will know it. It's a software that supports workflows in software development, team collaboration, and a lot of software related tasks. And so Jira software, customers who want to use Jira software have a choice between different payment models. So one option is to use the cloud product on the right-hand side of this picture. And this is the SaaS software as a service, use it over the internet, the data is stored in the cloud. And this is has a subscription revenue stream. Then Jira software is also available for people who want to host it themselves in their own environment. And there they have two alternative models that they offer to customers. One is the they call data center, which is a term license. So it's just like renting the software basically with a subscription model. And the third one, Jira calls that server. And it's the classic revenue model that we have in software, where it's a classic software licensing model, where people buy the perpetual license and then they pay on a recurring basis for a support and maintenance contract. And so what I find interesting is really this choice that's offered to the customers, and also that all revenue models have a recurring revenue stream in them. With the classic model, it's this support and maintenance contract, because that's something that software vendors really need in order to fund the ongoing development of their product. So that's, if we look at the, or if we remember that initial example with the ScanHead vendor and these additional software packages, it of course would look, how do I say, it would look logical to me if they would try to create such revenue streams as described here. However, there's a problem, and to use the value-based pricing that we have in the software industry for their software packages. However, there is a problem that unfortunately in the industrial space, value-based pricing often meets resistance by industrial buyers. What do I mean by that? Perhaps a little bit more explanation. So I think we, or what I see is that there's basically a dilemma. The IoT product includes or requires substantial amounts of software. And that software is, when it's more complex, it typically gets updated after the shipment of the product, which means, as I showed before, the IoT vendor needs to fund ongoing software development. And therefore, it would be ideal if they had a recurring revenue stream for that, like Jira software, for example. On the other hand, we have the decision makers in the industrial space, and they are often used to do pricing based on unit costs. And in the unit costs, even for the hardware product, the development costs are not explicitly included. And that is actually true for the decision makers at customers, so for example, an industrial buyer, but it even is often true for decision makers in our own organization. So for example, our own sales organization might be used to that model and might be reluctant to charge really money for software because it just isn't so substantial, doesn't feel so substantial and like a real product to them in a world where pricing traditionally was based on unit cost. So let's look again at this dilemma or at the attitude of the industrial buyers. So they are used to this pricing based on unit cost, and often when the product managers had done this bill of materials with the parts and labor costs, then often there was like a within the company some guideline that unit cost is a major driver for pricing decisions. And for example, as a first approximation, there might be some formula in the company, okay, typically our list prices are unit cost times a certain factor, for example, times two, but just as a first approximation, at least some guidance for the unit cost. The consequences of doing that are, first of all, typically and historically, these types of products had been sold with a one-time sale, so there's no recurring revenue for the vendor, which is a problem because of the ongoing software development. The unit price is expected to be comprehensive, or it means in that unit price should be included everything that the customer wants. In some areas, even some level of services, some support is included in that initial unit price. And also typically buyers have the expectation that these prices decrease over time, because vendors are expected to drive down unit costs, and when unit costs go down, then also the product should get cheaper because pricing is based on unit costs. So that is how it often was in the past. So what, and this is also the environment that IoT vendors often face still today. So what can IoT vendors do in that situation? So one thing I think a really critical first step is to be really realistic regarding the development cost for the software components. Typically, there will be initial software development costs. Everybody understands that. Then there's market introduction. But typically, the software development costs will have to continue Software development needs to be funded even after market introduction, and if it's a more complex package that gets more and more complex, then the software development costs will rise and not fall, like we had in the hardware example, where I said there's often a break between development cycles for different versions of the product, but not so in software typically. So what we really need to do here as IoT vendors is building awareness across the organization about the things that I talked about before, that how software is special, these different product life cycles, ship early, ship often, ongoing development costs, but also low unit costs. What we also need to make clear is that the unit costs, bill of materials and so on, reflects only part of the picture, because development costs are not reflected in unit costing and should not be reflected in unit costing, but they still need to be funded. So we need to find a way to do that. And if I look at industry examples, I basically see two ways to do that. The first option is to price the software really as a separate software product. If that's acceptable in the target market, then that's probably a really good solution, because also internally that helps the software team to be recognized, because it's a revenue generator and so on. So it makes it a little easier to also maintain the investment required to evolve the software product and so on. If we do that, to be successful with that, it's really this value creation is the foundation. We had that in the pricing pyramid as the basis of the pyramid, and we really need to have a very good understanding there. So we need to understand the customer's pains, what they get from using our software, what they're trying to achieve in their environment, jobs to be done. We need to create an offering that has a high value based on this understanding of customer needs. We need, ideally, if we can, we should also try to understand and calculate the economic value for the buyer. And we need to clearly communicate customer value. Again, that ties back to that pricing pyramid that we had before, value creation as a basis. For example, in the middle, we see this price and value communication, very important. And then I want to talk a little bit about the metrics, because that's also important to get right. We say as one rule, pricing metrics need to track with customer value. So that means they must be logical for customers. Customers should feel that if they pay a higher price or have to pay a higher price because the way the metrics are structured, that they also get a higher value. And something that is higher value in their perception, not in our perception as a vendor. And one thing where this is an example to demonstrate that is this discussion around pay-per-use pricing. Pay-per-use pricing has become hotly debated in the industrial space, because there is one very successful example with GE and their aircraft turbines and their power by the hour model, where GE basically charges not per turbine and separately for maintenance work or so, but it's really a price per flight hour. So if the airline has their airplanes grounded and they're not flying, then they don't have to pay. And if they fly more hours, then they pay more to GE. So we can clearly see how there is also this higher price for higher value. Because that was so successful between GE and the airlines, I've heard several other industrial component vendors trying to do that. What they learned is that their customers just didn't want it. They didn't see any additional value in that. I think this power by the hour has also something to do with some of the cost pressures that airlines are under and why they really like that. So the GE offering was based on a clear understanding of customer value. But in those other cases, it was really not appreciated by the equipment manufacturers, and this power pay-per-use model hasn't gained traction there. So that's what I mean with really understanding the value for the customer and having metrics that track with customer perceived value. Now, the other, or that was the first option. The second option, what we can do if really separate pricing, pricing the software components as separate products is not accepted in the market or is not practical for the vendor, then we really need to include it in the price of the offering, so with the hardware product, basically. And we cannot just give it away for free, which is the tendency in some high-tech companies that traditionally didn't do that much software. If we do that, we have to be careful, because if we keep our focus on the unit cost as a major driver for pricing decisions, then there is the risk of giving it away for free. We really have to look realistically at the ongoing costs and do a profitability analysis on the product level, just like for a software product. And one way to get value or get recoup some of the software investment is to consider increasing the uplift on the unit cost. So for example, if there was an old pricing formula that the list price is unit cost times 2.0, then we could consider a new price formula where we increase that multiplication factor and say, for example, unit cost times 2.2 or 2.5 to reflect the value that is contributed by the software components. To do that, we have to have really clarity on costs, and we also have to be very clear what the scope of our product is or of our offering. So we need, first of all, to understand the initial and ongoing costs for the software components, but we also need to clearly define the scope of the software components and what types of updates and services are included in the product price and which ones are not. And I'd just like to give an example here, or some examples, what could be done to give something to the customer, but also to have a clear limitation of the exposure for the vendor. For example, what we could include for free, I mean, in the base price of the product, software for updates, for example, just for bug fixes, but not for new software functionality. We could say we give customers updates for a limited time frame. The length of the time frame that's acceptable depends, of course, on the longevity of the product. Could be 1 or 2 years, or if it's a long-living product, like 5 years or longer. But we would then also make it pretty clear that after that, either we don't provide updates anymore, or we would provide them, but then at an additional fee. We could say, yeah, if we really continue to evolve the product very heavily, then we could say in the current base price included are the updates for the current major release version, so all the minor releases that are related to this version, but not for the next release. The next major release with major new functionality will require a significant charge upgrade fee for the customers. Or we could say, for example, on the services side, we provide 6 months of support or some months of support. And after that, support is will be charged, for example, by call or with a support contract. And then if we look back at our example with the laser scan heads, and if we think about which of those software components could be separate software products or would be candidates for that, then I would say it's there's a tendency that the first one, the config, is probably going to be, there will be probably pressure from customers that they want it included in the base product, while for example this marking job management, defining and controlling the marking jobs, is probably the most likely candidate for charging separately for that as a software product. Yeah, and with that, I would like to concludes my presentation and open it up for Q&A. There is our chat window, the question window, and let's see.
Yeah, thank you, Barbara. It was a very interesting presentation. I will check if there are any questions. So, no questions currently. So, if you have any questions currently, feel free to ask your questions by using the chat function or using the question function. And Barbara, Hans, Bernd, and I will be happy to answer everything. So currently there is no question. I will wait a few minutes more. And if you should have any questions or comments or feedback later on after our webinar, feel free to just contact Hans, Bernd, or Barbara. Mm-hmm. You see their email addresses here on the screen. That's also possible, of course. So I will check it again.
So Hans Bernd has a question, I believe.
Oh, there's another question. Barbara, I think it's a question to you. What is the best or most profitable pricing structure?
One that is really best, how do I say? Accepted by customers, and then if it, in order to be accepted, really based on a deep understanding, especially of the jobs to be done, because the jobs to be done is a strange word, and if you're not familiar with it, that's by Clayton Christensen, and what it's really about is that he says customers are hiring a product to get a job done for them. That's even true for consumers, and it's certainly true in the business-to-business space. And in order, if we really deeply understand what customers are really trying to do, to achieve, or what kind of problems are keeping them up at night, and then based on that, it's possible to develop a very good value proposition, and then based on that, designing the metrics and the pricing.
Okay, thank you, Barbara. And Hans Bernd has also a question, I think.
Barbara, I have a question. When you apply this hardware logic that the price should be based on unit cost to software, it would mean that software should be free, right? Because
yeah, that's basically why I said we shouldn't do that.
Well, I've heard that argument from industrial companies. It's when you are in that logic, that's the consequence, that software should be free, which is obviously not reasonable for a company that is a software vendor or vendor of a software intensive offering. So yeah. When I look at the current situation, for example, at Volkswagen, they have just announced that they want to raise the percentage of software in the cars that they develop by themselves from currently, I think it's less than 10% to about 60% over the next couple of years. Do you think that decision is related to this pricing topic?
That's just my personal opinion, but I would think if I look at companies that really, I think they, it's perhaps part of the pricing topic, but also if they have more, if more of the software is controlled, if they have control over a bigger part of the software, then they have better ways of really, again, this value creation. Because right now, a lot of the software comes from the different component vendors and they kind of stitch it together. But really, this like dramatic value improvements are hard to do that way. And I guess I would assume that they want to have higher control over the entire software that's in the car, so that they can really do more, more dramatic value improvements.
Yeah, but that's a total change of the strategy. That is not the strategy that they have used on the hardware side. On the hardware side, they have always tried to reduce the percentage of components that they develop themselves and get more from outside vendors. So with software, they are trying to do the opposite. So there must be a business reason for that, right?
Yeah, and I think it's perhaps it's driven by ability to have a better handle on pricing, but I also would think that competitive differentiation is a key driver behind that. Because okay. If they just use the software components and stitch them together that their suppliers give to them, then the suppliers give the same software components to the next car company.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this competitive differentiation is harder.
Yeah. Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Hans-Bernd. There are no further questions at the moment. So thank you, everybody, for joining our webinar today. And enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sabrina. Thank
Bye-bye.
You.
Bye, everybody.
Everyone. Bye.
Bye.